If you're tired of these promos, supporters get the podcast early and ad-free. Just go to donate.bogosity.tv for the links to sign up. Welcome to the Bogosity Podcast for the week of August 6, 2023, the podcast that's sitting on a cornflake. This is your host, Shane Killian. Let's complexify the news of the bogus. So, let's review. In August of 2019, Joe Biden said, quote, "I have never discussed with my son or my brother anything having to do with their businesses." The next month, it had morphed to, he never spoke to Hunter about his, quote, "overseas business dealings." In 2022, over several occasions, then White House Press Secretary Jen Psaki said the president stands by these claims. June of this year, Biden is asked, "Did you lie about never speaking to Hunter about his business dealings?" To which he answers simply, "No." Now the claim has morphed, according to both Joe Biden and Press Secretary Karine Jean-Pierre, to he, quote, "was never in business with his son." And after all of the evidence we now have of Joe Biden sitting in on Hunter's phone calls with Burisma executives and Ukrainian officials, the claim is now, I kid you not, they were just talking about the weather. And the evidence keeps piling up. Peter Schweitzer, author of Secret Empires, which covers the Biden family crimes, says that one of Zelensky's top officials was sitting in the room when they were discussing the multi-million dollar bribes with the Bidens. And Schweitzer suggests that Zelensky may be using this as a source of pressure over the president. He said on Fox News, quote, "If you look at that 1023 form that the FBI released, if that document is true, that document reveals that one of the people that was at those meetings that heard the conversations about bribing the Bidens worked for President Zelensky. Who really wants to believe, if that meeting took place and that document is accurate, that that individual did not go and report to President Zelensky what he heard?" This is big, but it's gotten lost amid the latest revelations from Devin Archer, Hunter Biden's most important business partner, who sat on both the Burisma board and the Chinese private equity fund with Hunter. And it's also gotten lost amid another suspiciously timed indictment of Donald Trump, this time for allegedly leading the January 6th conspiracy to insurrect the Capitol building, charges that, curiously, didn't include either insurrection or seditious conspiracy. Schweitzer closed off with a great point, quote, "The Democrats that continue to cling to the notion that there's nothing here, there's nothing to see, are making a big strategic mistake." Seriously, why are the Democrats not just throwing him under the bus? Not for nothing, but if that were a Libertarian Party guy, that's exactly what I'd do and what I'd encourage other Libertarians to do. Say, look, this is not who we are. This is not what we tolerate. How can they be actively running interference for the copious and ever-growing evidence of Joe Biden's criminal bribery and foreign influence peddling? You may say, well, they might be co-conspirators, but there are just too many for that. It really just comes down, once again, to the way your mind is poisoned when you join the cult of the omnipotent state. If you're looking for a way to support this channel, but you don't have any spare cash and you can't stand ads, you can do so by generating your own cryptocurrency. Use the links at the bottom of the description to follow the link to odyssey.com to listen to the podcast and see all of my YouTube videos as well. Just watching videos will produce cryptocurrency for the creator and yourself. And since Odyssey is always monetized and never censored, you'll have no problem seeing all the videos from your favorite creators. You can also use the library credits you create at Odyssey to tip creators and even purchase paid content. Earn library credits through various rewards, including daily view rewards and the number of shares and invites. And you can interact with creators in all sorts of ways, including like and dislike, comment, boost a post by supporting it, repost it, and share to other sites, all while earning crypto for the creator. Easily monetize yourself and your favorite creators using cryptocurrency, without advertising. Use the link below to visit this channel on odyssey.com and see many of your other favorites there as well. Speaking of the January 6th Capitol riot, again we see why they didn't want the videos released. U.S. Capitol Police Sergeant Aquilino Gonell claimed that he was beaten with a flagpole and his hand was sliced open, hit with so much chemical spray that the liquid soaked through his clothing to the skin, and told CNN, quote, "They called us traitors. They beat us. They dragged us. And I could hear them. We're going to shoot you. We're going to kill you. You're choosing your paycheck over the country. You're a disgrace. You're a traitor. It was very scary, because I thought I was going to lose my life." He also claimed that he could barely walk and ended up needing surgery. He repeated all of these claims under oath in sworn testimony before the Jan 6 committee. After 2.5 years, we finally have some more video of the event, enough to see that Gonell has been lying through his eye teeth the whole time. In video taken during the aftermath of the riot, when other officers were trying to resuscitate Roseanne Boyland, Gonell's hands can clearly be seen completely wound and blood-free. He's walking around fine with nary a limp, even kicking items out of the area, and there's no indication of any type of chemical spray on his clothing. He's also shown taking off his gear, with no indication of wounds to his shoulder or anywhere else he mentioned as he went into detail during his testimony. Gonell is still out on disability on the taxpayer's dime. There's an additional link in the show notes to Declassified JK over on Rumble, which has all sorts of previously unseen video from January 6th from both security cameras and body-worn cameras, including protesters who are walking around in the public area of the Capitol, carrying flags and taking pictures, calmly and non-violently, when Capitol Police come in and start shoving and grabbing people, initiating violence that doesn't seem at all likely to have escalated or even broken out at all without the Capitol Police instigating it. And yet, the news media is completely silent on it. If your only source of news is CNN, MSNBC, The Washington Post, and The New York Times, you'd be completely unaware that these videos were released at all. You can't even see them on YouTube because they're almost instantly taken down. All of this video should have been released immediately following the occupation amidst all the arrests and histrionics. That the lion's share of it is still unavailable to the public today is unconscionable. Doubly so since it wasn't even available to the defendants in court. Most notably, Gonell testified in the trial of Kyle Fitzsimmons, who was sentenced to 7 years on 11 charges. Gonell testified for the prosecution, where he repeated what we now know to be lies. This video was Brady material and absolutely should have been turned over to the defense. Remember that when a federal prosecutor says they turned over everything a defendant needs. We should have been seeing all this from the start. Instead, they keep it hidden from us as much as they can. And every time we do see a new video, it proves everything we've been told is a lie.
If you're on the Wi-Fi in a coffee shop or hotel, anyone on that network can get your traffic. Do you really trust all of those strangers? For that matter, do you really trust your ISP? A VPN can protect you from prying eyes, disguise your location, and even foil government sensors. It's essential in this day and age, so go to vpn.bogosity.tv and you'll be taken to BoxPN. Starting at just $2.99 a month, you can get unlimited high-speed connections to VPN servers all over the world, and they don't log connections, so your privacy is assured. Traveling abroad, just VPN home, and don't worry about what those other governments are doing. Back at home, stop your ISP from traffic shaping and messing with the quality internet access you're paying good money for. You can connect from multiple machines at once, including your smartphone or tablet, and it supports all the secure standards, including OpenVPN and SSTP. Bypass sensors and surveillance with your own secure VPN connection. Go to vpn.bogosity.tv.
Mm-hmm. If you're wondering why all the lies about the opioid crisis keep going without public criticism, look no further than Texas A&M Professor Joy Alonzo, who was suspended for criticizing Texas's Lieutenant Governor Dan Patrick. Alonzo is an expert on opioids and was placed on paid administrative leave and investigated in what is absolutely political interference in both free speech and higher education. She had just gotten home from giving a routine lecture on the opioid crisis when the complaint came not only from her supervisors, but from Chancellor John Sharp. Less than 2 hours after she finished speaking, Patrick's chief of staff had sent a link to her professional bio, and Sharp had sent a text link back that said, quote, Joy Alonzo has been placed on administrative leave, pending investigation re-firing her. Should be finished by end of week. 2 hours. That's how long it takes for someone's remarks to lead to direct censorship from the government. Alonzo had been invited to speak by Professor Chandler Shelf, and she immediately contacted him. Texas A&M has confirmed a series of phone calls and text messages that started with a student who is the daughter of Texas Land Commissioner Don Buckingham, who served 6 years in the state Senate with Patrick. Patrick not only endorsed her run for land commissioner, but also attended her wedding in May. At no point did anyone point to anything Alonzo said that was offensive. The lecture wasn't recorded, but the slides show the science behind opioids, how to prevent overdoses, and how to administer naloxone. She also criticized the state for not having a medical examiner in many counties and the lack of proper reporting on opioid deaths in emergency rooms. The course coordinator sent an email to the entire class saying, The statements made by the guest lecturer do not represent the opinion or position of the University of Texas Medical Branch, nor are they considered as core curriculum content for this course. UTMB does not support or condone these comments. We take these matters very seriously and wish to express our disapproval of the comment and apologize for harm it may have caused for members of our community. We hereby issue a formal censure of these statements and will take steps to ensure that such behavior does not happen in the future. They didn't specify at all what statements they were talking about. But one student, who spoke with the press on condition of anonymity for fear of retaliation from the school, said students were wondering if it was when Alonzo said that the lieutenant governor's office was one of the reasons it was hard for drug users to access care for opioid addiction or overdoses. Another student said, quote, We've been left wondering exactly what it was they objected to. That vagueness just leads to some more self-censorship, since it's hard to tell what is and isn't allowed. Self had written last October, quote, I can't tell you enough how much the students value this presentation. I get feedback all the time from them telling me how important they view this talk. They'll come up to me even months later to tell me. Adam Steinbaugh, attorney for FIRE, the Foundation for Individual Rights and Expression, said, quote, It would be highly inappropriate for a university to conduct an investigation if a faculty member says something critical of a state leader or a government official. That is, I think, a misuse of institutional resources, and it's one that will have a chilling effect, and that has a chilling effect, even if you wind up clearing the professor. A&M Professor Marsha Ori, who co-chairs the university's opioid task force with Alonzo, said, quote, The incident in Galveston yesterday is probably an indicator of how sensitive and politically charged this topic is, and the need to tread lightly and be aware that anything can be taken out of context. It's a shame because all we want is to make people aware of harm reduction strategies that can save lives, especially among youth and young adults who are especially vulnerable these days. Alonzo has been a vocal proponent of Narcan, a nasal spray that can reverse the effects of opiates and save lives in overdose cases. She's also advocated the legalization of test strips that can detect the presence of fentanyl in other drugs. She's given away more than $4.5 million worth of naloxone in her training sessions. But Patrick and other state officials instead opted for their typical drug warrior approach of increasing criminal penalties and police action. And that's the real truth they never want you to know.
They don't seem to want to end the problems of drug addiction and overdose, because the war on drugs is one big way politicians in both parties maintain their power and serve as excuses to intrude on our constitutional rights. Do you have children or nieces or nephews? Are you homeschooling or just want to counter some of the socialist indoctrination most children get in school? If so, go to bogosity.tv/tuttletwins and you'll be taken to a website where you can get some great books for elementary age children. The Tuttle Twins books are books about liberty and free market economics that include children's versions of Bastiat's The Law, Leonard Reed's I, Pencil, and Hayek's The Road to Serfdom, as well as books about the Federal Reserve and how regulations protect business cronies. They'll learn about the harm caused by eminent domain or regulations passed in the name of safety and fundamental concepts of liberty. And as you can see from the sample pages on the website, they're all easy to read and nicely illustrated. They're just $9.99 a piece, or get a special discount as well as free bonuses when you purchase all five. You can even buy in bulk to donate to schools and local libraries. So get the Tuttle Twins books at bogosity.tv/tuttletwins.
And now it's time to buy Cerate, this week's biggest Bogon emitter. And it's another one for the UK with regards to their horrible online safety bill, the bill that threatens free speech and privacy based on the usual fear-mongering about encryption. The bill also targets speech that is, quote, lawful but harmful. In a blog post, the EFF wrote, "The online safety bill, now at the final stage before passage in the House of Lords, gives the British government the ability to force back doors into messaging services, which will destroy end-to-end encryption. No amendments have been accepted that would mitigate the bill's most dangerous elements. If it passes, the online safety bill will be a huge step backwards for global privacy and democracy itself. Requiring government-approved software in people's messaging services is an awful precedent." The bill would mandate content filtering and age checks on certain offensive content. It also requires detailed reports about online activity to be sent to the government. In response to public outcry, the bill has undergone some changes, but nothing that actually improves things. The bill would require search engines and other service providers to provide information about the internet activities of named individuals, and also allow Ofcom to remotely access information, making it an offense to provide, quote, information which is encrypted such that it is not possible for Ofcom to understand it. In response to the objections involving a loss of user privacy, the government said, quote, "We expect the industry to use its extensive expertise and resources to innovate and build robust solutions for individual platforms and services that ensure both privacy and child safety by preventing child abuse content from being freely shared on public and private channels." In other words, just get the nerds to nerd harder. But as we've pointed out many times, there's just no mathematically possible way to give the government a way to view the content without also opening up the content to foreign agents, hackers, and others. A group of firms including Signal, Threema, and WhatsApp wrote an open letter saying, quote, "Around the world, businesses, individuals, and governments face persistent threats from online fraud, scams, and data theft. Malicious actors in hostile states routinely challenge the security of our critical infrastructure. End-to-end encryption is one of the strongest possible defenses against these threats, and as vital institutions become ever more dependent on internet technologies to conduct core operations, the stakes have never been higher. The bill poses an unprecedented threat to the privacy, safety, and security of every UK citizen and the people with whom they communicate around the world, while emboldening hostile governments who may seek to draft copycat laws." Signal said in a statement, "When the Iranian government blocked Signal, we recognized that the people in Iran who needed privacy were not represented by the authoritarian state, and we worked with our community to set up proxies and other means to ensure that Iranians could access Signal. As in Iran, we will continue to do everything in our power to ensure that people in the UK have access to Signal and to private communications. but we will not undermine or compromise the privacy and safety promises we make to people in the UK and everywhere else in the world. All of this happens as the EU's Digital Services Act goes into effect, despite warnings that its restrictions on, quote, hateful content is just a front for enabling government censorship of speech that officials don't like. And I, for one, think it's clear that this sort of thing is just going to keep happening until we finally wrest the internet away from any and all possible government control the way it was intended from the beginning. So all that makes the UK this week's biggest Bogon emitter. I want to tell you about the eyeglasses I've been wearing for years. As people can see on my videos, I have a very strong prescription, which makes glasses more expensive, especially when I need computer glasses, reading glasses, prescription sunglasses, and most expensively, progressive lenses for general everyday wear. To save money while still getting quality glasses, I get them from Firmoo. In fact, I just got a pair of progressives with high-index aspherical lenses and a nice pair of frames my wife loves for just over $100. It would have been $500 to get them through my eye doctor. Not only do they look good, the glasses are durable. I've worn many pairs for several years without problems. All orders come with a 30-day return policy, a 3-month warranty, and one-on-one customer service. Go to Firmoo, that's firmoo.bogosity.tv, anytime you need quality glasses at a low price. Once again, that's firmoo.bogosity.tv. And now let's deseriate this week's... And this week, it goes to Treasury Secretary and former Fed Chair Janet Yellen, who just can't understand why this spendthrifty, out-of-control government had its credit rating downgraded. We covered this the last time it happened during the Obama administration, when Obama basically bullied the credit bureaus into increasing the rating, even though nothing had improved. Yellen said, quote, Fitch's decision is puzzling in the light of the economic strength we see in the United States. The rest of us are asking, what economic strength? Fitch had downgraded the credit rating for the United States from AAA down to AA+, indicating that U.S. Treasury bonds are a riskier investment than they were previously. That'll raise the costs imposed on government whenever they increase the national debt, which is all the time. As of this podcast prep, the national debt was almost $32.7 trillion, a debt-to-GDP ratio of almost 120%. The debt per taxpayer is over $250,000. None of that, of course, is counting unfunded liabilities, which exceed $192 trillion. The company said in a statement, In Fitch's view, there has been a steady deterioration in standards of governance over the last 20 years, including on fiscal and debt matters. The repeated debt limit political standoffs and last-minute resolutions have eroded confidence in fiscal management. In addition, the government lacks a medium-term fiscal framework, unlike most peers, and has a complex budgeting process. These factors, along with several economic shocks as well as tax cuts and new spending initiatives, have contributed to successive debt increases over the last decade. Additionally, there has been only limited progress in tackling medium-term challenges related to rising Social Security and Medicare costs due to an aging population. They also mentioned how all of this out-of-control spending was pushing up interest rates and making it difficult for the Fed to meet its goal of bringing inflation down to 2%. The Biden administration has been bragging about their performance in job growth and other economic indicators, ignoring the fact that all of this is a result of a regression to the mean after COVID lows. Meanwhile, White House Press Secretary Karine Jean-Pierre decided to, once again, blame Donald Trump. Quote, The rating model used by Fitch declined under President Trump and then improved under President Biden, and it defies reality to downgrade the United States at a moment when President Biden has delivered the strongest recovery of any major economy in the world. I don't really need to explain how that's all a pack of lies, do I? White House economic advisor Jared Bernstein took a similar tack, quote,
Fitch seems to be punishing the cleanup crew when the guy who wrecked the room is long gone.
It's the same old song and dance we saw during the Obama years. Everything bad was Bush's fault, everything good was to Obama's credit. The fact is, as anyone familiar with basic math can tell, the trajectory this country is on is completely unsustainable. And the Biden administration is not only doing nothing to address that fact, they're continually making it worse. So all of that makes Janet Yellen this week's... Well, that wraps up this It's Enough to Make You Heave edition of the Bogosity Podcast. I hope you enjoyed it. If you did, please go to donate.bogosity.tv for several ways to support and discord.bogosity.tv to join the discussion. Subscribe at Patreon or Subscribestar, and you can listen early and ad-free. Thank you for listening. Until next time, here's a quote from H.L. Mencken. The kind of man who wants the government to adopt and enforce his ideas is always the kind of man whose ideas are idiotic. The Bogosity Podcast is licensed under Creative Commons Attribution Non-Commercial No Derivatives 4.0 International License. Bogosity.